Hello friends, welcome to my channel Physics Boy.
Today I will discuss about general aptitude for upcoming GATE examination. I had a dream to make videos for GATE exam and to help students who are preparing for upcoming GATE examination. So you will get a series of videos on general aptitude section for upcoming GATE examination on my YouTube channel. Each of these videos contains questions according to the syllabus for general aptitude. You know, general aptitude section is common to all paper. You can score 12 to 15 marks easily from this part in the GATE examination. My goal is to help you to prepare for general aptitude section and score 12 to 15 marks from this section. So friends, let's begin with 1 marks questions. For correct answer, you will get 1 marks, and for wrong answer, you will get minus 0.33 marks. So friends, be careful for negative marks. Question number 1 is the way in which the game can be played dash potentially infinite. You have to fill the blank with a suitable word from the given alternative A, B, C and D. I request you to pause the video and try to solve the questions and then play and watch the solutions. The suitable word is R, that is option C. So the way in which this game can be played R potentially infinite. So option C is the correct answer. Question number 2. If you choose plan P, you will have to dash plan Q, as these two are mutually dash. If you look at the option A, forgo and exclusive, you know that forgo means leave, or you can say give up, and exclusive means independent or restricted, or you can say separate. So for this sentence, forgo and exclusive, this word pair will be appropriate. So, if you choose plan P, you have to forgo plan Q, as these two are mutually exclusive. So, for question number 2, option A will be correct answer. Question number 3, if A and B are integers and A minus B is even, which of the following alternatives must always be even? Now, in this question, A and B are integer, means A and B can take any value 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. and A minus B is even. As A and B can take any integer values, so I can choose A is equal to 7 and B is equal to 3. So both A and B are odd number in this case. So A minus B is equal to 7 minus 3 is equal to 4, which is a even number. Now, if you take A is equal to 8 and B is equal to 4, that is both A and B are even numbers. So A minus B will be 8 minus 4 is equal to 4, which is also even number. Now, if you take A is equal to 8 and B is equal to 3, that is A is even and B is odd. So A minus B will be 8 minus 3 is equal to 5, that is a odd number. And now if you take A is equal to 7 and B is equal to 4, so A is odd and B is even, so A minus B will be 3, which is also odd number. In the given question, A minus B must be even. So A and B must be either odd or A and B must be even. That is, if you take A and B both are odd or both are even, then only you will get A minus B is equal to a even number. Now look at the option D, AB minus B. Now I made a table for you where A, B
and a minus 1 and b into a minus 1 are four columns, where if we take a and b both are odd, then a minus 1, that is a is odd, so if we subtract 1 from a odd number, then we will get a even number. So b multiplied by a minus 1, that is a odd number, is multiplying with a even number, so we will get a even number, that is b times a minus 1, that is the last column and second row, will be a even number. And now if you take a and b both even, then a minus 1 will be a odd number, so b multiplied with a minus 1, that is b means a even number multiplied with a odd number, which will give us a even number. So option D, that is ab minus b, will be always a even number. So option D is the correct answer. Question number 4 is, a couple has two children. The probability that both children are boys, if the older one is a boy, will be option A 1/4, option B 1/3, option C half, and option D 1. Which one will be the correct answer? As in the question, the older one is a boy means first children is a boy. So second children could be either a boy or a girl. So the probability that both children are boys, if the older one is boy, is equivalent to the probability that the second children is a boy, and the second children, that is the first children is boy, is fixed, and the second one either be a boy or a girl, the first children is a boy. So the second children could be either a boy or a girl. So the probability that the second children is a boy is half, that is 50% chance that the second children could be a boy or a girl. So option C is the correct answer. Question number 5. P looks at Q while Q looks at R. P is married, R is not. The number of pair of couple in which a married person is looking at an unmarried person is 0, 1, 2, or cannot be determined. Which one of the alternative is correct? It is not clear from the question that Q is a married person or a unmarried person. So let us first assume Q is a married person. So from the question, P looks at Q, that is a married person looks at a married person, and Q looks at R. So Q is married, we assume that. So Q looks at R means a married person looks at a unmarried person, that is R is not married, which is given in the question. So in the first case, where we assume that Q is a married person, where the number of pair of people in which a married person is looking at an unmarried person is 1, that is Q looks at R, that is Q is a married person and R is a unmarried person. So this pair will be valid. Now if we assume that Q is an unmarried person, then from the question, P looks at Q, that is P is a married person and Q is unmarried person in the second case. So P, that is a married person, looks at a unmarried person, which is valid. And in the second case, Q looks at R, that is Q, unmarried, looks at R, which person is also an unmarried person. So Q looks at R, which is not valid in this case. So here, that is, if we assume Q is an unmarried person, here we will also get one pair. So Q is married or unmarried, whatever be the case, in the both case, number of pairs of people in which a married person is looking at an unmarried person is 1. So option B is the correct answer.
Now let's go for 2 marks questions. For correct answer, you will get 2 marks, and for wrong answer, you will get minus 0.66 marks. Friends, be careful for negative marks.
Question number 6. I request to pause the video and read the paragraph and answer this question. Which of the following is closest in meaning to cleaving? From the above paragraph, it is clear that cleaving means divide or split or partition. So option D, that is splitting, which will be the correct answer. X bullocks and Y tractor take 8 days to plow a field. If we have the number of bullocks and double the number of tractors, it takes 5 days to plow the same field. How many days will it take X bullocks along to plow the field? 30 days, 35 days, 40 days, or 45 days? Which one of the alternative will be correct? According to the given problem, we can construct the equation as the field is same. And from this equation, we can compare the strength of tractor and bulls. So we get Y tractor is equivalent to 11x by 4 bulls. Say it will take P days to plow the field by the X bulls alone. So P times X bulls is equal to 8 times X bulls plus Y tractor as in the previous case. So by solving this equation, we get P is equal to 30. So option A is the correct answer. You can pause the video and watch the detailed solution. Question number 8. There are 4 women PQRS and 5 men VWXYZ in a group. We are required to form pairs, each consisting one woman and one man. P is not to be paired with Z, and Y must necessarily be paired with someone. So in how many ways can 4 such pairs can be formed? Option A 74, option B 76, option C 78, and option D 80. So we have to find in how many ways can 4 such pairs be formed. As there are 4 women and there is a restriction that each pair consisting of one woman and one man, and also we have another restriction, that is, P is not to be paired with Z and Y must necessarily be paired with someone. So in total there are 4 × 4 × 3 × 2, that is 96 ways. In these 96 ways, there are few such pairs where Y is not present, but in the given question, Y must necessarily be paired with someone. So now we have to find in how many ways we can make pairs without Y, and we have to subtract 96 to these many ways where Y is absent. Now we have to omit, or we have to remove Y from the men's group. So we get V, W, X and Z in the
men's group and women's group PQRS are the same. So from this number of ways, 3 cross 3 cross 2 cross 1, that is 18. In 18 ways we can construct such pairs where y is absent. Now if you want to see how these 18 ways can form 4 set of pairs where y is absent, pause the video and see the list. Here in every list you can see there are 6 ways, but in the last where P and Z is forming pairs, this 6 pair we have to remove because P is not paired with Z is given in the question. So finally, number of ways can 4 such pair be formed is equal to 96 minus 18 is equal to 78. So option C is the correct answer. Question number 9. All people in a certain island is either knights or knaves, and each person knows every other person's identity. Knights never lie and knaves always lie. P says both of us are knights and Q says none of us are knaves. Which one of the following can be logically inferred from the above? Option A, both P and Q are knights. Option B, P is a knight and Q is a knave. Option C, both P and Q are knaves. And option D, the identities of P, Q cannot be determined. There is no clue in the given question to understand who is knights and who is knaves. So we can determine who is saying true or who is saying lies among P and Q. So option D is the correct answer. Question number 10. In the graph below, the concentration of a particular pollutant in a lake is plotted over days of a month in winter and a month in summer. The red graph is correspond to summer and the black graph is correspond to winter. And you can see from the graph that the days of month are plotted along x-axis and pollutant concentration in ppm unit is plotted along y-axis. Now consider the following statement based on the data shown above. Number 1. Over the given months, the difference between the maximum and the minimum pollutant concentration is the same in both winter and summer. And second statement is, there are at least 4 days in the summer month such that the pollutant concentration on those days are within 1 ppm of the pollutant concentration on the corresponding days in the winter month. Which one of the following option is correct? Option A, only statement 1. Option B, only statement 2. Option C, both statement 1 and 2. And option D, neither statement 1 and nor statement 2. Let us first consider the black graph, so which is corresponding to the winter. PC maximum minus PC minimum, where PC means pollutant concentration. So maximum pollutant concentration minus minimum pollutant concentration in winter, that is if you see the red graph, the maximum pollutant concentration is 8 and minimum pollutant concentration is 0, so difference is 8 ppm. Now consider the red graph, that is summer. Maximum pollutant concentration minus minimum pollutant concentration in summer is 9 ppm. I request you to pause the video and watch the graph carefully. Now
as the difference between the maximum and minimum pollutant concentration in the summer and winter is not same. So statement 1 is wrong. Now look at the graph. As the days of a month are plotted along x-axis, so look at the day 10 to day 14. In these 4 days, red and black graph are very close to each other within 1 ppm of pollutant concentration. So statement 2 is correct. So finally, option B is the correct answer.
It's this much for today. Next day, I will discuss with you a new practice set for your GATE examination. So please stay tuned with me and subscribe my channel to get notification of new videos. If you have any doubt, query or any suggestion, then please feel free to comment below. Finally, if this video is helpful, then please like it and share it with your friends. Thanks for watching and all the best for your upcoming GATE examination.